Thank you. Good morning. I hope Sunday's treating you well, and welcome back to the Conservatory. I hope that you've had a really good week and that you're all fit and well and raring to go. And I want to especially say hello to all those who've started schools and colleges this week. I hope that you're settling in well to your new school terms, especially Charlotte and Joshua and Rebecca. As I record this, I'm aware that tomorrow new COVID rules are brought into place, but that doesn't affect places of worship. And also, rest assured that we're going to continue to stream this from the Conservatory service every week. We're going to produce our DVDs and our CDs for those of you who have no internet, because we want to ensure that you can all continue to worship God in the comfort and safety of your own homes. It's great to get back to worship after my sabbatical, and I want to say a huge thank you to all of you who've sent me positive words over the last week. You have no idea how welcome a positive word is at this time. We need to remember that our buildings are but bricks and mortar, but the church is a movement that fills this world with God's love and grace. Today we're going to hear all about forgiveness and relationships, and I'm extremely pleased that we've got Reverend Michael Holland giving our main message. But we're going to open our worship with a word of prayer. So I invite you to still your hearts and your minds and let the words flow over you in peace. Let us pray. God says, I love you often because it is my nature, for I am love myself. I love you deeply because it is my desire, for I long for everyone to love me deeply. I love you long because I am eternal, for I have no end. Dear Heavenly Father, we ask that you will bless this time of worship. May you be the peace we so desperately seek in these confusing and often worrying days. When our spirit fails, Lord, we pray that you will give us the strength to go on, to push past the darkness and search for the light. And when the light seems so dim, Lord, we pray that you will simply hold us in your arms, supporting and sustaining us, and whispering those loving words in our ears, that we are loved and precious. We pray that you will open our eyes to see your grace within the world, the wisdom to imitate you in our dealings with others, and to fill our universe with outrageous and unconditional love. In the precious name of Christ, we ask this. Amen. That awareness of our calling to imitate Christ is what drives us on as Christians. To know that we follow a rabbi that loves beyond measure, who puts aside even his own life in order to show love to an oppressive nation. No one said that following Christ would ever be easy, but although the cost may be high, the rewards of a transformed world and a transformation of ourselves is well worth it. And so we're going to sing about that now as we sing a song by Chris Tomlin, simply called I Will Follow You.
I will follow. soul. In you there's joy unending, sure. In you there's life everlasting. In you there's freedom for my soul.
One of the things that I got to rediscover during my sabbatical was this wonderful world in which we live. To get out upon the ocean again and feel the power of a wave under my surfboard, and to experience the enormity and the expanse of that sea. It always reminds me of the enormity and the expanse of God. It also reminds me of that truth, that as we discover more about God, we recognise just how little we know of him. With that in mind, we bring our prayers to God as we connect ourselves to the creator and sustainer of this entire universe. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, you are so majestic and so powerful. You permeate every aspect of our universe, and we feel your closeness in every autumn breeze. You are the God of the mountain splendor, of glorious skies and mountain streams. God of nature, of new birth, wakening spring and summertime, we praise you and see your grace throughout our world, in the faces of children, and the experience lining the faces of the elderly. We see your beauty in our neighbour and our friends, in the actions of those who assist us and those who need assistance. Dear Lord God of awesome power, every created thing dances to your song, resonates your glory, and sings of your magnificence. Each atom reflects your laws, and every particle speaks of your wisdom. You are a God who redeems, who promises compassion and love and forgiveness, a God who guides and shapes and transforms a world full of hate into a place of peace. Loving Heavenly Father, we praise and worship you. We thank you, Father, for the love that you show to all your creation. Help us to love as you love, to accept each person for who they are, acknowledging that each is precious in your eyes. Forgive the prejudice, intentional or not, that causes us to turn aside, ignore the need, or walk away. You are the source of all forgiveness. Help us to embrace our own forgiveness and offer it unconditionally to others. Give us the strength to be honest with ourselves when the lives we lead do not reflect the words that we profess, when we do little to bring respect to the name Christian. Transform us and reshape us into the people who see the Christ light in the eyes of all humanity, and to treat the world around us as we would have you treat us. In Christ's name we ask this. Amen. And I invite you to join with me in the modern words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. I always say that our faith is all about relationships, that life in general is all about relationships. We have the power within us to decide whether those relationships with others will be positive or negative. It is human nature to gather in groups of like-minded people, to connect ourselves with people who think and act the same way that we do, to have similar values and attitudes. And so we create our own echo chambers where we believe that we are representative of the world because everyone we speak to agrees with us. Where there is a dissenting voice, we shout it down. We reject it and return to our original view, which is supported by the group to which we belong. We're going to hear a reading now from Paul's letter to the church in Rome. Here Paul is desperately trying to unite Jews and Gentiles in this new Christian movement, based on the concept that God's love extends to all humanity. Here we see Paul trying to deal with the way so many different life experiences are being brought together under this new banner. So we hear from Romans chapter 14, and I'm reading from the Message version of the Bible.
Romans chapter 14, verses 1 to 12. Welcome with open arms fellow believers who don't see things the way you do. And don't jump all over them every time they do or say something you don't agree with. Even when it seems that they are strong on opinions, but weak in the faith department. Remember, they have their own history to deal with. Treat them gently. For instance, a person who's been around for a while might well be convinced that he can eat anything on the table, while another, with a different background, might assume he should only be a vegetarian and eat accordingly. But since both are guests at Christ's table, wouldn't it be terribly rude if they fell to criticizing what the other ate or didn't eat? God, after all, invited them both to the table. Do you have any business crossing people off the guest list or interfering with God's welcome? If there are corrections to be made or manners to be learned, God can handle that without your help. Or say one person thinks that some day should be set aside as holy, and another thinks that each day is pretty much like any other. There are good reasons either way, so each person is free to follow the convictions of their conscience. What's important in all this is that if you keep a holy day, keep it for God's sake. If you eat meat, eat it to the glory of God and thank God for prime rib. If you're a vegetarian, eat vegetables to the glory of God and thank God for broccoli. None of us are permitted to insist on our own way in these matters. It's God we are answerable to, all the way from life to death and everything in between, not each other. That's why Jesus lived and died and then lived again, so that he could be our master across the entire range of life and death and free us from the petty tyrannies of each other. So where does that leave you when you criticize a brother? And where does that leave you when you condescend to a sister? I'd say it leaves you looking pretty silly, or worse. Eventually, we're all going to end up kneeling side by side in the place of judgment facing God. Your critical and condescending ways aren't going to improve your position there one bit. Read it for yourself in Scripture. As I live and breathe, God says, every knee will bow before me. Every tongue will tell the honest truth that I and only I am God. So tend to your knitting. You've got your hands full just taking care of your own life before God. Amen.
Well, as those of you who are regular viewers of our From the Conservatory series will know, as far as possible, I always try and speak on the gospel reading from the lectionary for the week. I like to ground my teaching and my learning in the words of Jesus. This week, though, Michael has that privilege, and I have to admit I'm a little jealous because I love the gospel passage, which we'll hear a little later on. I may stray into it in this short talk now, and for that, Michael, I apologise. The passage that we've just heard from the letter to the Romans is, though, a work of art. This is Paul at his best for me. Now, I know that Paul sometimes gets a bad press, mainly because of the way in which the church has sometimes chosen to interpret his attitudes towards women. But we have to remember that Paul is writing to a first century audience and is in fact extremely progressive in his inclusion of all within the life of the church community. Here in this passage, we begin to see something of that. We see Paul at his liberal best. Romans is a book that is a collection of circular arguments. As Paul runs through the difficult task of how does a Jewish sect break free from a them and us identity? How does a new movement ensure that all of these people from different backgrounds and experiences and previous religious teachings come together in an equitable way in order to form a community that is grounded in love, grace, compassion, and inclusiveness? Throughout this letter, Paul circles around and around, trying to ensure that none of the groups meeting in Rome could feel alienated or elevated. And in this chapter, we see a snapshot of what the church should be like. I have been a regular attender of a Methodist church for my entire life. I was first taken to church at the age of only a couple of weeks old. And I would say that in the main, I was blessed to attend a church that loved me and accepted me for my entire life. But for many, that's not the case. And the reality is that as we read this passage, I wonder how many of us could truly say that it reflects the church community in which we place ourselves. This week, I replied to a tweet of a hero of mine. To give you a bit of a background and context, I was brought up in the 1980s, a fan of Welsh rugby and football, living in England at a time when Wales were not performing well at either sport. I therefore became the butt of many jokes at school, and as my national teams failed to achieve time after time after time. During this period, though, there was one moment that shone like a light. The World Cup qualifying campaign for the 1986 World Cup in Mexico. I was 11 years old when Wales, despite having beaten Spain 3-0, eventually only managed a draw with Scotland and as a result failed to qualify. We had such a good team at that time. We had Mark Hughes and Ian Rush, and in goal we had Neville Southall. Southall now works with disadvantaged and misunderstood children in school, keeping them motivated and attending. And he was reporting how some Christians had sent him messages this week condemning trans people and those in same-sex relationships. As I read the tweet, I thought to myself, is this what we've become? So many respects, the church has become known for what it is against, rather than what it is for. We're viewed as judgmental, as out of touch, and as opinionated by many in our world. This issue with so many is not faith, it's religion. It's the labels that we attach to people. It's the unwillingness to see another person's point of view and the alienation of those who are different, who don't fit the standard to which we would call others to. In truth, if we're honest, many of us don't reach that standard either. Many within church communities see those who are different to themselves as somehow offensive to God. But the reality is, and I hope that I preach this to my dying day, that God is love and that we are all created in his image. We think that maybe we are the gatekeepers of the religion, when the truth is, we're anything but. 2,000 years ago, Paul writes a letter to a church in the centre of the known world and declares that we need to welcome those who think differently to us. We need to learn and grow and develop into people that love without boundaries, without exception. The reply that I sent to Neville Southall's tweet emphasised this point, that God's love extends to all, and that all people are wonderfully and beautifully created in his image. We embrace the diversity in the kingdom of God. We accept that we're not always right and that we learn and we grow through listening to opinions that run contrary to our own. Our eyes need to be open to seeing the Christ that flows through and is in all elements of God's creation. And in doing so, we will begin to empathise and experience a whole different level of God's love and grace. In a few minutes, we're going to hear a story about the unforgiving servant. This story begins with Peter asking Jesus, how often should he forgive? The reality is that that question shouldn't even need to be asked. Forgiveness for the way in which we've treated others in our world is and has always been given to us, without our petition. It isn't therefore an optional extra for the Christian community. It is a mark of who we are as a community of love and inclusion. It's not a bolt-on. It's a necessity. Jesus, in going to the cross, demonstrates the depths to which our forgiveness should go, to the end of the world and back again. If we claim to be disciples of Jesus, then we should be known for our love, for our inclusiveness, and for our welcome. And so with that in mind, we're going to listen to our next song, maybe even sing along with it. Let love be real.
Let love be real in giving and receiving, without the need to manage and to own. A haven free from posing and pretending, where every weakness may be safely known. Give me your hand along the desert pathway. Give me your love wherever we may go. As God loves us, so let us love each other, with no demands, just open hands and space to grow. Grasping or confining, that strange embrace that holds yet sets us free, that helps us face the risk of truly living, and makes us brave to be what we might be. Give me your strength when all my words are weakness. Give me your love in spite of all you know. As God loves us, so let us love each other, with no demands, just open hands and space to grow. Let love be real, with no manipulation, no secret wish to harness or control. Let us accept each other's incompleteness, share the joy of learning to be whole. Give me your hope through dreams and disappointments. Give me your trust when all my failings show. As God loves us, so let us love each other. With no demands, just open hands and space to grow. With no demands, just open hands and space to grow.
I hope you enjoyed that song. As we come to our gospel reading, I'm aware that I haven't yet done anything for our younger viewers. And I would normally have read you a story. So with that in mind, I have some special guests to introduce to you. They're going to introduce our passage. So in a minute, I'm going to hand over to Hand and Mouth, after which we'll hear a brief psalm, and then Michael will bring our message for today. So enjoy. Hand to Mouth.
Today's story is rather a sad parable. I wonder what you'll think of it. One of Jesus' disciples went to ask him how many times he had to forgive his brother. Is it as many as 7 times? He asked. No, said Jesus, 70 times 7. And he went on to tell the disciples a story to show them what the kingdom of heaven is like. There was once a king who was checking up on how his servants were doing, looking after the accounts. One man was brought to him who owed the king millions of pounds, and he didn't have enough to pay it back. So the king ordered the man and his wife to be sold as slaves, with his children and all that he owned, to help to pay off the debt. But that man fell on his knees and begged, "Oh, be patient with me. I will pay you back all that I owe." The king felt sorry for the man. He forgave him the debt and he let him go. Now that very same man went out and met a fellow servant who owed him just a few pounds. He grabbed him by the coat, nearly choking him, and shouted, "Pay me back what you owe me." And the other servant fell to his knees and begged for mercy. "Oh, I will pay you back, please be patient." But the man refused, and he threw the other servant into jail until he paid him what he owed. Now the other servants saw what had happened and they were disgusted. So they went and told the king. The king sent for the servant and said, "You worthless slave, I forgive you all that money just because you asked me to. You should have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had mercy on you. The king was very angry and sent the man to jail until he could pay back his debt. Then Jesus said, "That is how my Father in heaven will treat you if you refuse to forgive your brother from the heart." So you see, we have a very sad tale which could so easily have had a happy ending if only the man had been as generous as the king.
What on earth was that crash? Have you broken something, Mina?
Oh dear, oh, it's this ornament of my mum's. Oh, she's going to kill me.
Was it a special one?
Oh yes, it certainly was. My dad, he bought it for her when they got married. Oh, it cost him loads and loads of money, loads.
Well, I'm glad it's you and not me. I'm off out of the way before your mum gets back. My favourite ornament. What has happened?
I'm really sorry, Mum. It was an accident. I will pay for it out of my spending money week by week. I am really sorry, Mum. Honestly, I am.
But what happened, Mina?
Well, I was running down the stairs, but the carpet on the bottom step came loose, and I caught myself on the hall table, and the ornament, it fell off.
Oh, it's not your fault, Mina. Accidents happen. I forgive you. Don't worry. I will get your dad to mend the carpet before someone else falls.
Oh, thank you, Mum. Thank you.
What you got there, Mina?
It's my new Game Boy.
Can I have a go, please?
Okay, you can have it till after I've been in the shop. I'll see you in a little while. Can I have it back now, please? It's good, isn't it? What score did you get? What?
I can't make it start up again.
What? What have you done to it, Charlie?
It was an accident, Mina. A lad on a skateboard bumped into me. And I dropped it. I'm sorry. I will pay for it out of my spending money week by week.
Oh, no, that's not good enough. I want it replacing now, or else.
Can't do that.
Oh, yes, you can. You can go and tell your parents you need the money now.
My dad has lost his job. I don't know how to ask him.
Well, just go.
Hey, Mina, you are back soon?
Oh, Mummy, I'm really mad. Charlie has broken my new Game Boy, and he says he can't pay me back. Well, I've told him he has to go home and borrow the money from his mum and dad.
Oh, dear. Did he do it on purpose?
Well, no, I don't think so. A boy on a skateboard bumped into him and made him drop it.
And you're making him pay for it?
Well, yes, of course I am. How else can I get a new one?
Well, I think you ought to consider what I said to you earlier.
Earlier? What earlier?
Oh, you have a short memory. My favorite ornament.
Oh, but that was an accident. Oh. Oh, I see what you mean. You think I ought to forgive Charlie, don't you? 'Cause you forgave me.
The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always accuse, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his steadfast love towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far he removes our transgressions from us. And as a father has compassion for his children, so the Lord has compassion for those who fear him. Hello again. It's good to be with you and to be sharing today's gospel reading with you. Now, this is going to be my last time with you for a little while because I'm beginning a period of sabbatical leave. So I'm going to leave you in the capable hands of my colleagues and look forward to seeing you just before Christmas. Today's gospel reading begins with Peter asking Jesus how often he must forgive his brother. And I can't help but feel sorry for Andrew here and wonder what he must have done to upset his brother so. 7 times, asked Peter. Rabbis of the day said that 3 times was enough. But Jesus is clear, not just 7 times, but 77 times. So often that you lose count. So often that you don't even count. And in this way, we mirror how God forgives us. Now, we know that forgiveness is not an easy issue, but it's nevertheless an important one. Jesus goes on to tell a parable, beginning with those words, "The kingdom of heaven is like." This phrase, "the kingdom of heaven is like," is setting up the story that follows as illustrating the importance of forgiveness if we want to live as if we are in God's kingdom. The story, of course, presents someone who has been forgiven lots being harsh and unforgiving in a little. The story of the unforgiving servant drives home the message. The story invites us to side with the underdog and then leads us to realise that as we accuse that unforgiving servant, that we are in fact accusing ourselves of the same conduct. The unforgiving servant is thrown into prison until he can repay his debt, which of course he cannot. It's not enough to claim to be forgiven, but we must allow God's grace and forgiveness to be evident in our lives, in how we too forgive others. To say, "I forgive you," is not enough. It needs to be repeated whenever we feel a sense of a grievance rising up in us. I don't know if you've had the opportunity to see any of the Despicable Me films over the last few years. I believe there's another one coming out, which I'm looking forward to. But Gru, the arch-villain, adopts 3 children to help him in his criminal schemes. But as he begins to love them, he needs to learn how to be a father to Margot, Edith and Agnes. In the second film, he meets and falls in love with Lucy, and needs to learn how to be a husband. And in the third, Lucy needs to learn how to be a parent, a mother to the 3 girls. And Gru needs to be reconciled to his estranged brother Drew, as they too learn to forgive each other for their past hurts and wrongs. Because they discover it's only by forgiving that they can find healing for the past, peace for the present, and hope for the future. Now, the films tell us a lot about living as a family. They tell us a lot about human nature. And they say something about forgiveness. As the characters get it wrong, as they upset each other, and as they learn to forgive and to love. And it's only by forgiving that they find healing for the past, peace for the present, and hope for the future. But the challenge for us is, how do we respond? Do we ignore it, or do we recognise the effect that this can have on our lives, on our families, and on our communities? Psalm 103 reminds us that the Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. God promises the hope of forgiveness. He promises a new start, a fresh beginning. And in Jesus, we saw the same thing lived out, and we saw it taught, and we saw us invited into this new way of living. We are encouraged to live this way. When I am offended and when I am wronged, I too have to forgive, because God forgives me. And there is the challenge. The challenge that also just persists, that sometimes we need to forgive ourselves as well. Just like in those films, we, like Gru and Lucy, have to learn to forgive our children when they annoy us. And just like Margot, Agnes and Edith, our children have to learn to forgive us when, as their parents, when we exasperate them. Gru and Lucy, as husband and wife, need to learn to forgive one another. Drew and Gru need to confront the past and forgive. And so the same is true for us in our families, in our wider families, in our church families, in our wider community, in our nation, and in our world. And I do worry about the political nature of discussion at the moment, where forgiveness is absent in our cancel culture. Without forgiveness, we have no solutions. Jesus' parable provokes the question, how can we expect God to forgive us if we don't forgive others? There's a story from South Africa of Sister Margaret Magdalene, who was describing how when she was browsing the theology department of a reputable bookshop in South Africa, where she came across a pile of books containing DIY voodoo kits. Each contained a little rubber effigy, a row of glass-topped needles, a book of curses and spells. And on the lid of the box was a picture of a hostile crowd with ugly expressions and shaking their fists and clearly hurling abuse at an identical effigy that was stuck all over with pins. And at the bottom of the box it read, "Revenge therapy for the overstressed." And she contrasts this with the elderly lady before the Truth and Reconciliation Committee, who, when Archbishop Desmond Tutu asked her, "What do you want the commission to do for you?" She answered, "I want you to find the person or persons who tortured my husband and who murdered my son, so I can look them in the eye and say, I forgive you." Two approaches to hurt. Which world would you rather live in? Now, we know that forgiveness is difficult. It's hard. It demands a lot of us. And perhaps impossible, some might say. But we know that we follow a God who does the impossible. All this is made possible by God's love and God's grace towards us. So we are called to forgive as God forgives us, graciously and abundantly. Lord, forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Help us, we pray. Amen.
Thank you so much for that, Michael. There is something incredibly beautiful about forgiveness, about that moment when we release ourselves from the burden of hate that others have placed upon us. We often don't want to forgive, because to hold on to that hurt means that we hold a power over another person. And that's just yet another reason why forgiveness in the Christian church is so very important. To forgive is not to forget, but to refuse to allow our past experiences to shape us in a negative direction. That forgiveness that we ourselves have received from God and from others reminds us that none of us are perfect. The story that Michael told to us about the Truth and Reconciliation Committee actually ended with those in the building that day spontaneously responding by singing Amazing Grace. And so we're going to sing that song now, albeit the Chris Tomlin arrangement, which reminds us as well that forgiveness breaks those chains and leaves us free to pass forgiveness on to others. So I invite you to join me in singing Amazing Grace.
My chains are gone. the earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever.
That song always gives me goosebumps. And as I think about the enormity of the story behind those words, the transformation of a slave trader into a man of peace, and the forgiveness that he sought for the pain and the suffering that he brought to so many lives. We continue our worship as we bring our prayers for forgiveness and for the rest of the world to God. Let us pray.
Dear Father, in so many ways we live in a broken world. We see injustice and oppression and hatred as the driving forces behind so many lives. We see a hurting and damaged world weeping and bleeding from the greed of humanity, refusal to compromise and an unwillingness to forgive. Help us to be a light in the darkness, a voice calling out in the wilderness, a people who react in love. As we look across society and see a country that's been torn apart by the impact of coronavirus, we think of the vulnerable and the isolated and those suffering from mental health issues. May we bring relief and comfort as well as companionship. As people worry about the security of their work, we pray that we may continue to provide for those in need. May we never see our giving as charity, but as fair and equitable distribution of the world's resources to our brothers and sisters. May we look upon those of different races, religions, genders, and sexuality as our family, seeing in them the reflection of the image of God, a God who creates all humanity equal. And may we work towards promoting unity where there is division. Living, loving, and gracious God, show us what is ours to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And so we sing our final hymn, a hymn that reminds us of the wonder and the majesty of our God as we sing his praise. How can I keep from singing your name?
Darkest night, for I know my Savior. Troubled times, sing when I win. I can sing when I lose my step and I fall down again. I can sing 'cause you pick me up, sing 'cause you're there. I can sing 'cause you hear me, Lord, when I call to you in prayer. I can sing with my last breath, sing, for I know that I'll sing with the angels and the saints around the throne. How can I keep from singing your
Thank you for taking the time to listen to this service. I hope that it brought you closer to God. And I want to give a big thank you to Michael again for bringing us his message and sharing God's love with us today. As I always say, if you haven't yet subscribed to our channel, then click on the link below. And also that we love your interaction. So please do drop us a line and let us know what we can do to make worship an even better experience for you and for others. I'm running an online Zoom Bible study on the 21st of this month, and if you'd like to get the Zoom link, again, drop me a line. The address should be on the screen, and I'll also put it in the comments section below as well. And don't forget that if you know anyone who may like to receive our service on DVD or audio CD, again, please let me know. We want to share our streaming, our services with as many people as possible. And of course, if you want to share our streaming link, you can do that with others as well. I hope that you all have a great week, and I look forward to bringing you more from the Conservatory next Sunday at 10:30 a.m. So I invite you to join me with the words of our closing blessing.
Dear Lord, remind us of our calling to encourage one another in Christian love, to show God to our community, and to develop our church, worship, and society into a place where all can find their home in Christ. Amen.
Go in peace, shining God's love and light into the world. And may the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit remain with each and every one of us, now and forevermore. Amen.